So what exactly this cloud computing is? So nowadays, everybody is running behind this cloud computing. So what exactly this cloud computing is? So let me introduce myself. So my name is Avinash. I have total 6+ years of experience in the field of IT administration. And I have migrated many of the on-premise infrastructure to cloud infrastructures. So I'm a AWS certified SysOps administrator. And I'm a Red Hat certified engineer as well as Microsoft certified professional. So this is a certification which I got from Amazon Web Services. So what we are going to learn today? So in this session, we are going to cover about cloud computing and why everybody is running behind it. And we are going to cover advantages of the cloud computing and what are the service models, what are the deployment models available in this cloud computing, and how this Amazon Web Services is related to cloud computing. And we are going to cover some of the useful tools for developers as well as administrators. So what exactly this cloud computing is? So I asked many guys, are we using cloud computing in our day-to-day environment? So 80% of the guys said, no, we are not using cloud computing. But that's absolutely wrong. We are using cloud computing technology in our day-to-day environment. If you have a Gmail account, that means you are using a cloud computing. So if you are holding a smartphone in your hand, either it may be an Android device or iOS device, that means you are using the cloud computing. Why? Because in that Android device or iOS device, they will cave. If it is an Android device, so that operating system is developed by Google. So by defaultly, they are giving Google Drive in your local device. So by defaultly, whenever you create your Gmail account, you will get 15 gigs of the storage. And for that 15 gigs, that Google won't charge you. So you can store unlimited files inside that Google Drive. You can share with your friends and you can upload, you can download anywhere from the world. So for example, I uploaded some file from Bangalore. Then later on, I moved to USA, North Virginia. So then if I am authenticating myself by using the same username and password, and I'm logging to Google Drive, I will find the files. Whatever I uploaded in Bangalore, I'm able to see the files in North Virginia. So if I move somewhere else, if I move to Atlanta, then if I'm authenticating with same username and password, then also I'm able to view same files. So here in backend, one vendor is managing all my files and he is making all those files available 24/7. So here the vendor is Google. By the same way, we may have Gmail IDs. So whenever you are authenticating yourself to your Gmail account, you will find some mails. So if you go to USA, if you log into your mail, and suddenly you won't get a mail from Trump. If you come back to India, if you log in yourself, and you won't get mail from Narendra Modi. So whatever the mails you have till now, you will get the same mails only. You will get only same mails. So here, that means you are depending on a vendor called Google, and they are giving a service called Gmail, and they are making all the data. Whatever the data we are holding, they are making the data high available and 24/7. You can log in anywhere. All you need is internet connectivity. That's it. Internet connectivity with a valid web browser. And you can use any of the device. You can use your own laptop. You can use your friend's tab. You can use your friend's phone, or you can rush to nearby cyber cafe. Then you can log in. You will able to get all the required data. That's exactly cloud computing is. So unlike other technologies, we have a definition for cloud computing. So if you ask me, what is the definition for Java? Java is a programming language. What is the definition for .NET? .NET is a programming language. It uses its own syntaxes and classes. So, but PHP, these are and all programming languages only. But unlike other technologies, we have definition for cloud computing. So here, some funny cartoons came and it just burst the market. So you can see, so cloud computing means you don't need to tie all your files to the balloon and you don't need to throw those to the clouds. So and you no need to climb top of the mountains and you no need to upload all your files to cloud. That's exactly not cloud means. So as I said, we have definition for cloud computing. So if NIST, National Institute of Standard and Technology, given one definition for cloud computing. So the definition is, cloud computing is a model for enabling ubiquitous, convenient, on-demand network access to a shared pool of configurable computing resources that can be rapidly provisioned and released with minimal management effort or service provider interaction. Oh, bit complex. I was not able to remember all this. So as a first step, let me simplify this. So this NIST definition is with some complex words and some different terminologies. Okay, let's keep that aside and we are going to simplify that one. Okay, so before that, let me tell some of the examples. Let me tell some of the on-premise examples as well as cloud examples. Then we will simplify this definition. So for example, so you have one organization, you want to start one more branch office in Hyderabad. So as you are going to build your office from scratch, so you need to configure your network. So you need to purchase desktops, you need to purchase servers, you need to worry about storage area network. So let me take purchasing the desktop or purchasing the servers. So first, what we will do, we will finalize the configuration. We means IT manager will finalize the configuration. IT department will finalize the configuration. Then they are not the key person to purchase. So obviously they have to send that quotation to accounting department. So what this accounting guys will do, they will send that configuration to different vendors. Like vendors called Dell, Google, HP, IBM, Lenovo. We have a number of the vendors who can deliver servers. So we will send our required configuration to different vendors. And what that vendors will do, vendors will quote price for that particular product and he will reply back to you. So if that price is okay, then you have to release one purchase order. You have to release purchase order. Then Dell will process our order. So then, and they will take minimum 2 to 3 weeks to deliver your server. Why? Because many of the servers have to ship from Vietnam. So it have to clear the customs and all. So obviously it will take around 2 to 3 weeks of the time. So, okay, finally you waited for 2 to 3 weeks. That server has come. And then what you have to do, you have to unpack that server and you have to mount that into your existing server rack. So then you have to configure some RAID. And you have to configure DRACs and all. So then you have to install operating system. Then you have to install operating system on top of that one. Then after that one, you can install the required software, whether you want to use that server for file server or database server. Then we have to install that one. And in some cases, directly we cannot push that server into production environment. First, you have to test the server capacity. You have to perform some stress test, load test. So that all will happen in UAT environment, user acceptance test environment. So then after, you will push your server to production environment. So that's exactly happens in real time. So this entire process may take around minimum of 1 month to 45 days. So okay, no problem. We waited 1 month to 45 days and we spend around 5 lakhs for each and every server. Then it was working fine. So down the time, after 6 months later, you got one more new project. So you recruited 200 more members. This server capacity is not sufficient. Then what you have to do, you have to purchase one more new server or else you have to upgrade this hardware. For upgrading this hardware, you need to take downtime. You have to shut down this server. So for that particular time frame, the service which is provided by that server will not be available for end user. So that's a drawback again. Okay, that's fine. However, if you got one more new project, if you recruit 200 more members, that's fine. But unfortunately, you lost current project and you are going to shut down your company. So you already spent 5 lakhs for each and every server. So you already spent 5 lakhs to run one single file server and you are going to shut down your company. So at that time, what you can do with that server, you cannot install normal operating system and you cannot use that server in your home. So obviously you have to sell that to a scrap shop. You can't do anything with that server. So you can't do anything with that server. So that's the big drawback. But if you use this cloud technology, instead of spending 5 lakhs at a time, you can pay monthly basis, you can pay hourly basis. So we have measured services in cloud computing. If you are taking data, we will measure the data capacity in terms of GBs, gigabytes. If you are taking any of other resources like servers, we are going to calculate in terms of hours. So if you run one server for a particular 1 hour, you have to pay for that particular 1 hour only. So here you can take one server, you can directly install your required software. You don't need to worry about the operating system also. Automatically Amazon have their all the operating system templates. You can pick one template, you can give how much RAM capacity you want, how much hard disk capacity you want, you can give that information, just click on finish. Automatically one server is going to provision for you. Then directly you can push that into production environment. You don't need to test in UAT. So if you are facing any performance issues, you have one option: change the instance class. So that means you can upgrade, or else you can downgrade your server. Just click on that one, select your RAM capacity how much you want, select hard disk capacity how much you want to upgrade to, click on finish. Automatically, without shedding that server, you can upgrade all your server hardware. So here we are not taking any downtime and you are not going to spend much on your IT infrastructure. So here, if you completely depend on cloud technology, if you completely depend on cloud technology, all you need is you have basic configuration systems with good internet connectivity. That's it. You can access all those servers. So instead of having data centers in on-premises, now many of the organizations are completely migrating their IT to cloud environments. For example, take Wipro. They are into migration. Take TechM. So they are completely migrating their database servers into cloud. And take Adobe. So it's one of the top 100 companies in the world. So that Adobe, their entire infrastructure is on cloud. So instead of spending on IT infrastructure, many of the organizations are completely depending on the vendors. That vendors are Amazon Web Services is provided by Amazon, and then Microsoft Azure, that is provided by Microsoft, SoftLayer, that is provided by IBM, Rackspace, so that's name also Rackspace only. So VirtuStream, we have many vendors and many new vendors are coming into the market. Why? Because this is going to be the future. And because of this automation process, many guys are losing their jobs. That we will discuss later. So now let me come and explain. So cloud computing is a model for enabling ubiquitous and convenient on-demand network access. So ubiquitous means temporary. Whenever you require, you don't need to wait for 3 to 4 hours directly, 3 to 4 months. Directly, you can log into the portal. You can log into the portal. Then you can provision your server. So whenever you're done with your work, you can terminate that one. So obviously that's a temporary one and a convenient one. And it's an on-demand network access to shared pool of configurable computing resources. So, okay, as we know, we may have Netflix or this digital televisions, DTH services, direct to home services. So in our homes. So in that one, we will find on-demand movie services. What exactly that is, whenever you will have one movie list, whenever you want to watch some of the movie, you have to select that one. You have to pay some rent for a particular 24 hours duration. So that movie will be available for that particular 24 hours. If you want to watch that movie 100 times, you can watch, but within the 24 hours only. So that's exactly, whenever you require any of the service, you can go and you can purchase that services. So here, those services are here, computing resources. That you can take networks, you can provision servers, storage capacities, you can launch your applications and you can run your services. So So these exactly are the computing resources provided by all the cloud providers, and that can be rapidly provisioned and released with minimal management effort or service provider interaction. So here, so let me, if I want to launch 100 servers, I no need to call to Amazon Web Services and I no need to ask them any permissions like that. So you will have your browser, you will have options, you can select your template, you can give how many servers you want to launch. So you no need to worry. For example, if you take Google Drive, so as a free tier one, you will get 15 GB. But if you want to increase that 15 GB to 1 TB, you no need to call to Google. There you will have one upgrade option. You have to click that one. So you have to define your required storage. Click on that one and it will show you how much they will charge you per monthly basis. Then you can select that one. So that's exactly here. We are not interacting with the service provider. So we are not interacting with any service provider directly. You are using their services on your top-up browser and without any service provider interaction, you can rapidly increase your capacities, you can rapidly decrease your capacities. So this is exactly NIST definition of cloud computing, National Institute of Standard and Technology. So in my words, cloud computing means storing, accessing data and programs over the internet instead of your computer's hardware. So if I store any of the file on my local device, if I configure any of the server on my local device, I'll able to access that resources within my network or within my device. But if you depend on this cloud computing, that you can go globally in minutes. You can go globally in minutes. That's exactly cloud computing is. So what are the advantages of cloud computing? So this is whatever the topics we discussed till now. So those all are advantages only, but again we will cover. So it's an on-demand self-service. So you no need to worry. You no need to contact Amazon Web Services to launch your service. Whenever you require any of the service, either it may be a storage, either it may be a server, either it may be any of the application. So then you can use this on-demand self-service. That's an advantage. So, and broad network access and high availability. So what exactly this broad network access is? So if you have any of your office resources, so for example, in my case, I have Lotus Same Time Connect. So this is my internal chat application. So that is my organization's internal chat application. So when I sit in my office, if I try to log in, it will show login successful. But if I try to log in from my home network, it will not allow me to connect. Why? Because that particular resource is configured to work within my network, within my office network only. So it will not work anywhere from the world. So for that one, again, you need to map some public IPs or some configurations required. That's completely out of the scope. But unlike that, whatever the resource you are launching through the cloud can be accessible anywhere from the world. Either it may be your home network, either it may be your coffee shop network, either it may be your friend's home network. You can access all the resources. All you need is good internet connectivity with valid web browser. That's it. And resource pooling. So what exactly this resource pooling is? So Amazon already built a huge network, huge infrastructure. They already built a huge data centers. So on top of the data centers, we are going to consume those resources. We are going to consume those poolings. So what they made, they are making one single server hardware to, they just made it as virtual interfaces. So instead of physical interfaces, they just made that resource as virtual interface and n number of the customers can use that one. So it's like, let me give one simple example. So when you are creating your Gmail ID, so you are getting 15 GB of the storage. So is Google maintaining a 15 GB of the server for each and every Gmail account? No, absolutely not. So they are having one single server. So on top of that single server, they are using some mechanism, and you are, whenever you are giving your username and password, so you are going and log into the particular 15 GB of the space. So that's exactly resource pooling is. So it's like you may hear about this car pooling. So whenever, so you are going on to some destination, if some other guy also want to go on that particular destination, then he will he can come along with you, and you both guys can go. That's exactly pooling means. So by the same way, like you only, if any of the customer want to launch their services on Amazon Web Services, so then all those resources can be laid down on a single hardware. But Amazon have their own mechanism. So they have their own mechanism for segregating that for customer to customer, that we will discuss in further sessions. So next is rapid elasticity. So this rapid elasticity means changing the values continuously. So rapid elasticity means changing the value continuously. So you are going to, you can provision your resources, you can increase your resources, or you can decrease your resources. So that's exactly elasticity means. So elasticity means changing the values. If you want to launch 100 servers at a time, you can select that 100 count and you can click on launch. So, and if you want to shut down that 100 servers at a time, select all those servers, click on terminate, automatically those servers are going to terminate for you. And it's a cost effective. So you don't need to spend 5 lakhs to 6 lakhs. Yes, you can scale up and you can scale down your resources rapidly. So, and instead of spending 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs on your IT infrastructure, you can pay around 5,000 to 6,000 per month. Whatever the server configuration you are getting in on-premises one, then you can spend 5,000 to 6,000 to get the same server in cloud. So that's cost effective. And all the services are measured services. Measured services means, so whatever the service you are going to use is going to measured in terms of hours or in terms of GBs. So whatever the resources you consume, you have to pay for that particular resource. So that's the beauty of the cloud computing. That method is called as pay as you go method. Pay as you go. So whatever the resource you are consuming, you have to pay for that particular resource. So these are the advantages of cloud computing. And we have three deployment models. So first one is public cloud, second one is private cloud, and third one is hybrid cloud. So this public cloud means it's like a public transport, or it's like a public toilet. Anybody can go and anybody can use that one. Absolutely, there is no restrictions. If you have a credit card, you can go to Azure portal, you can go to Amazon Web Services portal, you can create your account, then you can provision all your resources. So that's exactly public cloud is. Absolutely, there is no restrictions. It's open to the world. Then when coming to the private cloud, so for example, HP also having their own cloud technology. But unlike this Google and Microsoft and Amazon, that cloud technology will not be open for everyone. But that cloud technology can be used for only internal employees. So at that time, whatever the cloud technology, whatever the resource they are having in cloud will be consumed within your organization only. So it will not be open to the world. So at that time, those cloud deployment model is called as private cloud. So example for this private cloud is HP having their HP, and public cloud, Amazon Web Services managed by Amazon, and Azure and managed by Microsoft, GCP, Google Cloud Platform, which is very new into the market, and that is managed by Google, and the soft layer, which is managed by IBM. So these are the examples for public cloud and private cloud. Even my organization also having one private cloud. Private cloud means you are having your existing data center. That's also called as a private cloud. So third one is hybrid cloud. Hybrid cloud means it's a combination of public cloud and private cloud. So you already have some private cloud environment, but you don't want to invest much on that private cloud environment, and you want to launch some of the servers in public cloud. So at that time, you require connectivity between public hosted clouds and private hosted servers, public cloud hosted servers and private cloud hosted servers. So you can make connectivity between these two. At that time, your cloud deployment model is going to call as hybrid cloud. So it's a combination of public cloud and private cloud. Next, we are having service models. So these deployment models and these service models and advantages are same for all the cloud technologies. These deployment models not only related to Amazon Web Services. You take any cloud technology, so these are the same. These deployment models and service models are the same. So when coming to service models, we have total three. First one is software as a service, second one is platform as a service, and third one is infrastructure as a service. So let me give one silly example. So I'm only saying that's a very silly example. I hope all are Indians only, so you can easily understand this example. So first you go to nearby bakery, then so you want to eat donut, then you will go to nearby bakery and you will see the donut in the display and you will ask that guy to give the donut, then you will take that and you will eat that. But you will not ask him to customize the donut. So, hey, you are giving donut in circle shape. I want that in triangle. What that fellow will say simply, no, sir, this is not a customized product. So some manufactured this one and they are giving to me. So then I am selling that to you. So you will not get any option to customize this product. If you want, you can take this one. You can consume this. You can eat this. So that's exactly software as a service is. But coming to platform as a service, you can go to nearby biryani center. So when you are ordering that biryani, what you can tell, so you can customize that one. You can ask for extra rice, you can ask for extra masala rice, you can ask for leg piece, you can ask for chest piece, you can ask for more white rice. So that's completely, you are giving your inputs. You are giving your inputs, and while that guy is getting your biryani, he will make that biryani based on your requirement. But that means he is not going to prepare your biryani. Whatever the platform you have already, then he is taking your inputs, he is customizing that product and is giving to you. That's exactly platform as a service. Then third one is infrastructure as a service. That means, so staying alone in your home. So you will have your gas cooker, you will have your rice cooker, you will have your oil, you will have everything, whatever you want to cook. Then what item you want to cook, that completely your option. If you want to eat Maggie, you can prepare that one. So that's exactly infrastructure as a service. So let me come to technical terms. So first one is software as a service. What this software service is, so if you want to use any of the software, then you can log into Amazon Web Services portal and you can go to marketplace. You can search for that particular software. You can select that one and you can select the price, or you want to go with monthly subscription or hourly subscription. You can select that one. You can run plugin. Then you can use that software. For example, take MS Office. So if we want to run MS Office on my local device, I need to have one device. On top of that one, I need to have operating system. Then only I can install that MS Office software. So obviously I have to go to nearby Microsoft store and I have to spend around 10,000 to 12,000 rupees for the licensing of that one. Then I'll allow to install that operating system. I'll get 12-digit code. But if you depend on this cloud technology, software as a service, you will get your software. So here in my case, I have that. So here you can search for that in Amazon Web Services Marketplace. You will get. So if I want to run Microsoft Office 2016, 2013 standard 64-bit, I can select this one. And here I can see monthly subscription. So monthly subscription is coming for around $11 for each user. So $11 plus applicable taxes. So that's exactly you can use software as a service. So can we customize this one instead of this Microsoft logo? Can we place our logo? You will not get any option to customize that product. You will not get any option to customize your product. So that's exactly software as a service is. So when coming to example for this software as a service is Google. Google is a software as a service, and Gmail, your Google Drive. So many of the Google products are software as a service. So and S4 is example for software as a service also. Here in backend, do we know what operating system Google is using to launch our Gmail accounts? Do we know what exactly virtualization technology they are using to launch our Gmail account? You will not get any control over the backend processes. Whatever the software they are giving, you have to pick that one. You have to use it. You will not get any customized option. Then second one is soft platform as a service. So this platform as a service is example for this platform as a service is Salesforce. Salesforce also a cloud technology, but there you cannot launch any of the servers. You cannot provision any of the servers, and you cannot store your data. You can give your company data. You can build your application. Then that application will be used available for everyone. So, and here we have Elastic Beanstalk. That is example for platform as a service here. So in that one, your developer, or you can write your entire code. You can zip that entire code. You can upload to Elastic Beanstalk application. So then that Elastic Beanstalk will analyze your code. So it will analyze your code. Then what it will do, it will provision a platform for you. It will provision a operating system for you. It will install the required software on top of that one. It's going to deploy your code. As an output, you are going to get your deployed software application or deployed web page. So here you no need to worry about the operating system. You no need to worry about installing software on top of that one. Directly what you are doing, you are uploading your data. That's it. So here you are giving your inputs, you are giving customizations, then automatically one platform is going to provide it as a service. So that's exactly platform as a service is. And third, infrastructure as a service. So here in infrastructure as a service, you are going to get network, you are going to get storage, you are going to get servers, you are going to get virtualized technology on top of servers. So then whatever the operating system you want to choose, whatever the application you want to install, that completely end user's choice. That means your choice. So that's exactly infrastructure as a services. You are going to get all the resources to build a infrastructure. So that's exactly infrastructure as a services. So this diagram will explain that one. So if you say, if you're talking about traditional on-premise one, so you need to take care about your networking. If some cable got disconnected, your networking team have to come and they have to fix it. If you take storage, so one storage department have to be there, either you're using SAN or NAS. So they have continuously monitor your storage technology, and have some application team to maintain your server, system admins to maintain, and one VMware guy to maintain your virtualization. So then if you struck somewhere, if you are running out of storage, your team have to take care. So here you have to take care about all these services. These black color ones are you have to manage, and these blue colors ones cloud provider will manage. So here when coming to software as a service, you will not get access, you will not get any control over all these. We don't know what operating system they are using, to what server model they are using. You will not get any control. So when coming to platform as a service, you can give your data, you can upload your applications, you can use that applications. When coming to infrastructure as a service,
It's completely your choice. Whatever the operating system you want to use, whatever the middleware software you want to use, and how you want to run your application, whatever the data you want to provide, that's completely your option. So this is exactly service models available in the cloud technology. So is it clear, right? So this is common for all the cloud technologies, not only for Amazon Web Services. These service models and deployment models are similar for all the cloud technologies. Either you are going to learn Azure, or either you are going to learn Google Cloud Platform, or you are going to learn Amazon Web Services. So this is common. So what exactly this Amazon Web Services is? So Amazon Web Services is a secured cloud service platform offering compute power, database storage, CDN, content delivery network, and other functionality to help business scale and grow. So this is exactly Amazon's Web Services definition is. So you may ask me, as I am saying, we have many cloud providers like Azure, GCP. So why, you may ask me, why you want me to go with only Amazon Web Services? Why? Because AWS is the largest public cloud computing platform on the planet. And if you want to be the safest place in IT right now, go and learn some cloud technology. Why? Because let me come back to our previous slide. So here, if it is a traditional on-premise method, here we are going to have one networking team. We are going to have one storage SAN area, SAN, EMC SAN, or different team for the storage. So to maintain the servers, physical infrastructures, we used to have engineers. Then one virtualization VMware guy, who is a guy who have good knowledge about virtualization is required. So then operating system, your system admins, and then your application deployment team. So here in on-premise method, so we required around 5 to 6 teams to manage your IT infrastructure. But when this cloud computing comes into the scenario, all you need is you required 1 or 2 guys to manage all these. Why? Because you no need to worry about the physical infrastructure. Amazon is going to take care about that one. And you need only one guy who have good knowledge about networking, storage, servers, application deployment. That's it. So that means you are going to take out 5 members job if you learn this cloud technology. So because of the automation, many guys are losing their jobs. So here, as I said, Amazon Web Services is not a new technology or not a new process. So every process is automated and simplified by Amazon Web Services. Then we are using their services. So that's exactly cloud computing is. And more small and mid-level organizations are migrating or outsourcing their IT to Amazon Web Services. So these startups and mid-level companies, they don't want to spend much on their infrastructure. So if the product is click, then they can continue their organization. Otherwise, they can shut down their company at any time. So in such cases, you will not be ready to invest much on your infrastructure, right? So that's why many, many small and medium-sized organizations are migrating. So, and it is the fastest growing cloud computing platform on the planet. So actually my next slide will justify that one. This Gartner's Magic Quadrant, they do kind of surveys, and Amazon Web Services is named as a leader in infrastructure as a service segment. So we can verify that by this URL also. So here AWS named as a leader in infrastructure as a service for 6th consecutive year. Here you can see Amazon Web Services is top in leader segment. Microsoft is followed by, and Google is far below, and these Rackspace, VirtuStream is completely bottom of the table. So, and I would like to tell one thing, and this Amazon is giving 12 months free trial eligibility. So it's giving option to explore all the cloud services. So, but what other vendors are giving, for example, take Azure, they are giving 13,200 rupee worthy credits. And you can consume that credits, you can use that credits within 30 days. So obviously, we cannot learn entire cloud in 30 days, right? So that's why even GCP, Google Cloud Platform, also giving $300 worth of credits to explore their solutions, but that validity is for 1 month only. But when coming to Amazon Web Services, you are getting option to explore all their services for the next 12 months. So as we are talking, we are going to store our files in cloud. We are going to launch our servers in cloud. So what exactly that Amazon Web Services global infrastructure is? So do we get any option to choose our data center where exactly you want to deploy? Yes, absolutely. We have total 14 regions and 42 availability zones. Region means there is no technical term involved in this one. So Amazon segregated the entire world into different geographical locations, and they named that region with popular city. So here, if you take Asia Pacific, so as we know, Mumbai is a very famous one. So then they named with Mumbai region. So when you take this south of Australia, so Sydney is a famous one. So they just named it with Sydney, and here Japan, they named it with Tokyo. So those are the regions. So we have total 14 regions, and two new regions are coming soon. And here in bracket, you can find the numbers. So here in Mumbai region, we have two, the number. So the two means those two called as availability zones. Each region will contains minimum of two availability zones. Availability zone means it's a data center. Whatever the resource you are going to store, you will get option to select your data center. That means availability zone. So these are 14 regions and 42 availability zones till date. And this entire course is designed to have hands-on sessions only. So this course is 80%. 80% is completely hands-on. And what exactly you need to start with this course, you need to have one Amazon Web Services account. While you are creating your account, you have to give your credit or debit card details. They will deduct $1 or 2 rupees from your account to test that validity of your account. So then they will refund that amount also. And we are going to cover 80% of the free tier services only. So whenever I am launching any of the paid service, I'll intimate to you guys. So you have to be very careful. So whenever you finished with your lab, you have to close the resources to get charged from Amazon Web Services. So, and all you need is you need one AWS account and a computer with internet connectivity with a valid web browser. That's it. You can start your course. So then let me show you how exactly this Amazon's console will looks like. I'm just logging to my AWS account. So this is a portal. This is a page we are going to work on. That's it. This is the page. By using this URL, you can log into your AWS account anywhere from the world. And here you can see we have 14 regions. So if you now I'm in Hyderabad, so that's why I selected Asia Pacific Mumbai region. So if I want to switch to any of the region, I can go and select that one. I can provision my server in North Virginia region. And you no need to worry about installing operating systems and all. So it's completely simplified. You can go to EC2 screen, you can click on launch instance, you can select your required operating system, and here you can select how many virtual CPUs you need, how many RAM capacity you need. So you can see here, you can observe, even you can launch 2 TB of the capacity RAM also. Here you can observe the RAM capacity is 1952. That's almost nearby 2 TB. So this, my local device is having 8 gigs, and I'm feeling very happy. Oh, my device is very, very fast. But imagine if you have this 2 TB of the RAM capacity for your server. So and that too, you can launch that server in seconds. And whenever you're done with your work, you can shut down. Then you can, if you want to launch 100 servers at a time, you can give that count also. And then you can add storage. How much storage capacity you want to give? Whether you want to give 5 TB or 1 TB or 2 TB, that's completely option is yours. If you want to add one more drive, you can click on one more drive. You can give name and whatever the ports you want to open. You can give that port count, review and launch. Launch, here you have to give some key pair. So that's it. Your server is provisioned and it will be available to consume, it will be available to use. That's it. My server is ready. Even I don't know how to install this Linux operating system. But I provision server and I given to my end user, they already started working on this one. So then every process is simplified. We are going to make the services available based on our requirement. That's the beauty of this Amazon Web Services. Sure, definitely. So as I said, if you want to terminate, I can go to instant state and I can stop the server, I can reboot or I can terminate. That's it. I just terminated this server. So the server got shut down. So I'll get charged for that particular time frame.
Let me open this course content. So this is the course content. We are going to cover EC2, that means computing section, and storage section, we are going to cover S3, simple storage service, that's an object-based storage, and we are going to cover elastic block storage, elastic file system, storage gateway and snowball, and we are going to cover databases, so that is relational database, and we are going to cover database migration service and Redshift, Amazon's own data warehousing solution, and under networking and content delivery, we are going to cover Route 53. So Amazon's DNS version, so VPC, virtual private cloud, you can create your own data center within your AWS account, and CloudFront, that is content delivery network, and management tools like CloudWatch, CloudFormation and Trusted Advisor. You can monitor your AWS account by using these management tools, and security and identity compliance, that is we are going to cover identity access management. So this is the first step. First module, we are going to start with our course. And here, under application services, simple workflow and elastic transcoder, under messaging, simple notification service, simple queuing service, and simple email service. So whatever the mails you are getting about these demo sessions and all, those mails are configured by SES, simple email services. And we have one optional session, that is developer tools. So we have code pipeline, code commit, code build, and code deploy. So you will understand this developer tools if you have overview about the software development lifecycle. So if you have some knowledge about Jenkins, if you have some knowledge about some scripting, then these developer tools you can easily understand. But this is completely optional session. So this is a entire course content. So here again under storage, we are going to cover what is simple storage service, storage classes, versioning, lifecycle management, and we are going to cover cross-region replication. How can you host your website using S3 bucket, storage gateways? How can secure your S3 bucket data? So that's an object-based storage. So it's similar to Google Drive. We can say Google Drive version of Amazon Web Services. And here we are going to cover so what is root account and what is IAM account, and how you can enable multi-factor authentication for root user as well as IAM user, and how can you define your password policies, and what is the roles. So that we are going to cover. However, you can find all this course content in Naresh IT website, or else if you requested, my team will send you this entire course content to you. So this developer tools is optional one. So why that is optional one means, so if I come and talk about Jenkins server, if you are an experienced one, you can understand that flow. Why? Because whenever developer writes that code, whenever he checks in, so then automatically one build is going to prepare, it's going to deploy in deployment server. So then some test is going to perform on the deployment server. Then it's going to give test results to testing team. So then first it's going to deploy in UAT, then after when the testing team approves that one, it's going to deploy in production. So this is a regular flow. So we are going to automate this entire process. So obviously you need to have previous working experience or good knowledge on software development lifecycle. So then only you can understand that particular developer tools. So, okay, Abdul Sheikh is asking, if we don't know programming skills, we can start with this, and for this before starting AWS, what are the basics we need to learn? So absolutely, it is for freshers. So if you don't have any programming knowledge, that's no problem. So This course is designed to learn from scratch. So I'm going to tell about each and every service and how we are going to use that one. So if you have any programming, if you don't have any programming knowledge, absolutely no problem. Why? Because I'm not going to write any programming knowledges. And here in this dashboard, you don't have any terminal, you don't have any option to write. You don't have any option to write or develop your code. As I said, it's not a technology. We are automating that entire process. So that means obviously you don't require any programming knowledges.